Hi everyone. Today we want to finish our simple whack-a-mole game. We want to make it look a little bit nicer by adding some particle effects, and we also want to make sure that it works on mobile browsers as well as desktop browsers. It's been some time since the last tutorial, and Wade's evolved quite a lot since then. So first of all, in order to update your Wade or to download the new version, if you just like to go to www.clockworkchilli.com. You'll notice that the site itself has changed quite a bit. Now you can download Wade directly from the main page here. But you do have to be logged in, which is what I'm going to do right now. Right, now I've got this new zip file, so let's open that. I'm going to copy the latest version of the Wade engine, this JavaScript file here, plus index.html and style.css. Yes, replace everything. Now I can delete Wade 0.8. But now we'll have to remember to edit index.html and make sure that we're loading our awesome.js file. We've just overwritten this file, so we need to redo this bit here. So let's open the game in Chrome to be sure that everything went according to our plans. Yes, it's working. Background colour's changed for some reason, but that doesn't really matter. If you do want to change it, it's here in style.css. But we'll keep it like this for now because I don't really care. Now, let's see how we can make this game a bit better. First of all, let's fix the gameplay. I've created this new picture of a mole with red crosses where its eyes used to be, and I've called it deadmole.png. Let's load it in our load function. Wade load image deadmole.png. Now, in mole.js, when a mole is hit, we can tell its sprite to use this new image. We can get the sprite by doing var sprite equals this owner get sprite. And then sprite set image file deadmole.png. In fact, when a mole dies, we should probably store flag to remember that it's dead. This is dead equals true. Then we should only score point if the mole is not dead. If not this is dead. And finally, when the mole goes back up again, it's no longer dead. This is dead equals false. And this owner gets bright set image file mole.png. Okay, so let's refresh Chrome. Now you see, I've clicked twice on this mole, but I only got 1 point. So it's working, but it doesn't look particularly good. What I'm going to do is add a nice particle effect to highlight the fact that we've hit the mole. In the games folder, I've added a file called burst.png. I couldn't think of a better name. So if we open it, we can see that it isn't a single sprite, but it's a sprite sheet. What this means is that it's actually a series of sprites arranged in a rectangular grid. It's 4x7 in this case. These sprites, when shown in sequence, actually make up an animation. Now, Wade knows how to deal with the sprite sheet animations, and all we need to do is tell it how many rows and columns are in the grid. So, let's load this image as usual in the load function. Wade load image burst.png. And back to mole.js, where we kill the mole, let's play this animation. Var burst equals new animation. And we're using burst.png with a 4x7 grid, and we want to play 30 frames per second. So then we create a sprite called burst sprite. Now notice that it's an empty sprite. That is, I'm not passing an image file name into the constructor of this sprite. Instead, what I'm going to do is sprite add animation. Now I need a name here if I want to access this animation in future, so let's just call it particles. And let's use the burst animation that we've just created. So now I can just do sprite play animation particles. Of course, I still need an object to add to the scene, so let's get the position of our owner, and then we can create an object that uses the sprite at this position. Okay, so let's add it to the scene. Wade, add scene object, OBJ. Okay, but what happens to this object? I mean, we're going to play this animation, but surely we'll want to delete the object at some point. To be precise, we want to delete it as soon as it's finished playing its particles animation because we don't need it anymore. We can do this really easily with OBJ on animation end equals function. Wade, remove scene object, OBJ. Now, let's try it. Nice. Bit too small, perhaps, so let's change that. Sprite, set size, 350, 250. Okay, so that's done, and it's looking much better. So now let's deal with the potentially different aspect ratios that we might have. Unlike traditional games, this is going to be played on lots of different devices, so that's going to mean lots of different resolutions and aspect ratios. So how can we make it look good on as many different aspect ratios as we can? One way to test it is by resizing your browser window to whatever resolution you like. And you can see that we've got a bit of a problem. When the window gets too small, the game's no longer playable because bits of it start to get cut off. This is because we're assuming that we always have space for a 4x4 grid of holes and moles. If we're saying that one cell is 300 large, then that means four cells is 1200 large. But we're looking from further away. CZ equals 2, so everything's scaled down by 50%. This means that we need at least 600 by 600 area and pixels to be able to play our game. In fact, it needs to be a bit taller because we want to have room for our score text at the top too. So let's say 600 by 700 is the minimum resolution that we're going to need. All we have to do here is to tell this to Wade, preferably at the beginning of the init function. Wade, set min screen size 600, 700. So what have we done here? Let's see it in action. Let's start with a big window and see what happens when we make it smaller than 600 by 700. The content gets resized automatically. That's pretty cool because it means that the game can always be played regardless of its resolution. On the other hand, when we make our window bigger, what's going on at the moment isn't exactly ideal. The play area is always limited to the same size. It scales down but never scales up to fill the whole window. But we can fix that. Since we know that the area occupied by our grass background is 1024 by 768, which is half the size of the grass picture since we're looking at it from z equals 2, we can just do this. Wade, set max screen size 1024 768. This means that when we make the window bigger than 1024 by 768, the content is stretched, always preserving its aspect ratio though. Now, you might notice some green lines here in the middle of our holes. That's because we're stretching the content, so there might be some rounding errors, and the position or size of your sprites can be off by a fraction of a pixel. You might want to avoid that by making the two halves of our holes slightly bigger, so that when there is a rounding error, it's not so visible. So in hole.js, hole top, set size 258, 130, hole bottom, set size 258, 130, instead of the actual size, which was 256 by 128. Now, let's look again in Chrome. Everything looks perfect. Well, not exactly everything. The score text is still disappearing sometimes depending on the size of the window. This is because our resolution can change, and more specifically, the height of the game area can change between 700 and 768, which are the limits that we've set. Ideally, we'd like this score text to always be near the top of the screen, regardless of the current resolution. So let's see how we can do this. Instead of it setting its position to 0, minus 350, we can try to set it near the top like this. Minus Wade get screen height over 2. This is the actual top edge of the screen. Let's add a little bit to move it down slightly, say 32 pixels. Let's see what happens. It's in the right position, but as soon as I resize the window, it's in the wrong position again. We want to fix its position relative to the top edge of the screen. It's really easy to do this with Wade. Score object, set alignment, center, top. And there we go. Now it's always in the right position. Okay, so another big thing that's missing here is sounds. You may or may not know that audio in HTML5 is a bit of a big issue because it's not very well supported across all the different browsers, operating systems and devices. Wade does what it can to make sure that everything works on all different platforms. If you go to clockwork.com, you'll find an elaborate tutorial which gives you some different ways of implementing audio into your game. For this game, we're going to use web audio. Web audio is a really cool audio API that's supported by many different browsers, but not all of them, not yet anyway. It is supported by Firefox, Chrome and Safari, including the Android and iOS versions, but not Internet Explorer. Okay, we still want people to be able to play our games in Internet Explorer, but I think it's fine for now to just do it without the audio for simplicity. However, if you do want to support audio in different devices, then there's a tutorial on the Clockwork Chilli website that you can use. So what we're going to do is this. We're going to check and see if our current browser supports web audio. And if it does, we'll load a couple of sounds. In the load function, if Wade is web audio supported, Wade load audio ding.og, Wade load audio wrong.og. Okay, you might have noticed that in the game folder I've put in four sound files. We've got ding.og, ding.aac, wrong.og and wrong.aac. This is because most browsers support og and some other browsers support aac. So you'll need to have both versions in your game folder for maximum compatibility. However, you don't need to worry about this in your code. You just use the og version or the aac version, and Wade will know to use the other one internally on the browsers that need the other version. Okay, so then in the mole's onMouseDown function, when we kill a mole, let's play a sound. Wade, play audio if available, ding.og. I'm using play audio if available because the audio may not have been loaded if the web audio is not supported on Internet Explorer, for example. In the same way, we do this in hole.js. Wade, play audio wrong.og. Now, let's try it in Chrome. That's cool, isn't it? But do you think there's one thing missing? It might not be obvious if we're only testing this game on a PC, but it would be obvious if you're playing it on a tablet or a phone. There's no multi-touch support. If you tap with two fingers, only one of them registers at any one time, but it's really easy to fix. In your apps init function, Wade, enable multi-touch. Now we want to finish this simple game by adding a game over screen. So let's say when you miss a mole and hit a hole instead, it's game over. So in hole.js, on mouse down, instead of decreasing the score, we call Wade app game over. And in awesome.js, we create this game over function. This game over equals function. Now in here, we want to remove absolutely everything from the scene. Wade clear scene. Then we're going to tell our players that it's game over. Var text. This is the text that we're going to show on the screen. Var text equals game over, you scored, plus this score, plus points, tap to play again. You see the slash and n here, it's a line break, it's telling Wade that we want to start a new line of text after the slash n. Then we'll create a text sprite, var text sprite equals new text sprite, text 36px aerial blue center 3. And we add it to the scene. Wade, add scene object, new scene object, text sprite. Let's see now. Okay, but then when I click, the game isn't restarting, which is what I'd like it to do. Let's just add an onMouseDown function to our app. When the game over function's executed, the this keyword represents our app, so we can add an onMouseDown function to our app in this way. This onMouseDown equals function. And in here we clear the scene again. Wade clear scene. Then we disable the onMouseDown event for the app. Otherwise, every time the user clicks anywhere, this function is going to be executed again. So this onMouseDown equals 0. And finally, we call the init function, which is going to restart the game. This init. Now let's try it now. And there we go. So what we've got is a really nice game, which is even vaguely entertaining as well. Best part is it's only taken us about 45 minutes overall, and that's including explaining all of the steps. I'm pretty sure that with a little bit more time, you could make something really good yourselves. Don't forget that on clockworkchilli.com there are some cool sample games with all the source code that you could use as a starting point to make your own games. They all come with detailed explanations of how they're made as well. I really hope that you found these tutorials useful. If you have, give me a thumbs up, and we'll be back more with some more tutorials. Thanks for watching.